Hello, hope you're all well. Today we're going to revisit a watch I serviced a long, long time ago. I think it's up towards 8 years now, so very early in my watchmaking career. This was sold to a client of mine, and now it's got had some issues with stopping and not keeping time very well anymore. So it's time to have a look and give it another service. So it's got a very nice movement in it. I let's see, what's it called? I'll put it up on the screen. You can see the wear. That hole is turning into an oval, and we don't want that. So what I'm going to do is replace that upper barrel bushing. So before I'm taking the entire movement apart and servicing it, I'm just going to repair that upper bushing with the movement in situ, so that when we clean it, we'll also clean off any dirt related to fitting the upper bushing. There's no point servicing a movement, then making a repair, and then cleaning it again. So that's how we're going to do it. Take the barrel. I'm now going to measure the diameter of the, you can see where it's been scraping underneath here. It's not good, that's the way it goes. But what we're going to do now is just measure the diameter of the upper barrel arbor pivot. For that we're going to use my trusty micrometer. Size of the upper hole is about 0.78, so I need a 0.8 hole, I reckon, for that, because we do need to have 0.02 of a mil clearance as well, otherwise the jewel will be too tight. So I'll look in my box and see if I have a jewel for that size. Maybe we can upgrade it to an upper jewel rather than bushing. If not, we're going to make a bushing that fits. Proof is, of course, in the pudding. I do have some spare jewels that do have an inner diameter of 0.8 mil. So we'll see if they would do the job. Seems to be fitting very well. I'm going to have a look under the microscope and check the slack on that. If it's if I need the 0.78, no, I think this is the correct. The jewel seems to be pretty much spot on. Very happy with that. And yeah, now I'm going to broach out the upper plate and push this jewel in place. So what I'm going to do here is hit the hole pretty much in the center and manually open up the hole to the right diameter for the jewel to be fit in place. So you gotta make sure you're going absolutely straight here. Some people will set this up and turn it in the lathe, which is, I admire them for their way of doing things proper, but I do find this works very well once you get the knack of it. It's basically a question of going slowly until you hit the right diameter, and just make sure you're centered and in the middle. You can see it's a fairly thin plate on the top here. That's why it has been worn quite easily. Of course, you don't want to overshoot your hole size, use the bushing insert in the middle as your guide to make sure you're in the middle. As you can see, that's just pressed in from the back. I don't think it's a press fit, I think that's just machine, I'm not sure. Anyway. I'm going to do this under the microscope from now on, just to make sure I'm nice and straight, and I'll find out quite close now. What I'm going to do is remove the burr that's been created. Let's use a drill like that. I could use a reamer as well, but I don't have one right now. There we go. So it's very close to bee wearing arm. So now I'm going to go move very, very slowly as I'm broaching out, because just one turn with the broach too much and the hole will be too big. So I have got the diameter of the hole jewel here, very close. Got the wrong stake in. I've gotten the diameter of the hole here very close. So what I'm going to do now is simply press the jewel in place. Because the plate's so thin, I really want to have this as tight as possible when I'm putting it in. Let's see if I do it a bit fatter stake, this one's a little thin as well. And the jewels, of course, you really don't want to be hammering on that, because it will crack. So the best thing is just to exert force. Okay, I've broached a hole to very close to the diameter of the jewel, the outer diameter. And what I want to do now is simply just press it into place. Like so. Get that as tightly in there as possible. Using this push force, because I really don't want to be hammering on this. Get our jewel in, nice and flush, where it should be. So I just winded the movement and even got the long lift angle. That's for a different movement. There we go. Look. And the amplitude is spot on, it's pretty much perfect. So what was happening was that the barrel, because it was tilting with a worn pivot, was touching the central sweep second hand. So the wheel on that was touching the barrel surface. It's not doing that anymore, so we've got a nice straight line, no effects of that. But because I've been mucking around with it and it's dry, we're going to give it a service anyway for the longevity of the movement. We're back to square one. But it now has a jewel more than what it had a few minutes ago. So happy about that. Now I'm going to wind it down and start taking it apart. So we wind the movement down. We need to get a hold of the ratchet here. Slowly let that wind down. If you let the all the power off at once, the power of the hairspring will be released and you can damage your barrel teeth and your central pinion. I have done that before and I have paid for it, so I'd rather not do that. So let's align the hands. Beautiful dial on this. Go. These are case screws. So very, very nice dial. Beautiful patina, as we say. Just just another word of saying that it's aged, but we are perfectly okay with that. It's a 70-year-old watch, and it's allowed to show its age. In this case, the hand is fairly close to the dial. Just be careful like that. There we go. I couldn't really get it with the plastic protector, but as these are vinyl themselves, they very rare you get any marks or damage from them. The only way you can do it is you actually have any dirt on the tip of it. So in this case, it was fine. If your hour hand is too close to the dial, I recommend just lifting it off with the dial, as the grips of your hand removing tools will get too close and damage it no matter what. So your best off chance is to just lift the dial with your hour hand. Anyway, let's get those hands packed away. Next, we remove the dial. Let's get that a gentle lift from the underside of the dial, like so. This dial into a dial protection box straight away. I've got one of the fancy boxes for this one. There we go. These are just beautiful movements, and this one looks almost as nice as the day I serviced it, really. I think it's the best call of action now is to give this another service. But, to be completely honest, I think I should probably have spotted that barrel wear when the watch had been serviced. I think it was very, very close. It did work, but that's probably it was time to already change that when I had it. So I'm not going to charge the client for the new barrel bush replacement, because first of all, he's a very nice guy, and number two, I was the one who sold him this watch a few years ago, well, a long time ago now, I would say it was a mistake from my part not to replace it, even though it is about 8 years ago now, but yeah, I can actually remember looking at that being a bit borderline, but I think, yeah, well, it's going to be good for until the next service, and here it is at its next service, and I deemed it was time to have it done. So yeah, I'm if you buy a watch from me, I would expect it to be in fully working order and the way I explained it to be. So I might have been a bit negligent when I kind of moved on with that, but what can I say, I was young and dumb. Now I'm older and wiser, hopefully. Anyway, I don't want my mistakes to affect other people, so I'm sure he'll be happy for that. Just tightening the dial screws. I like keeping them in place when I clean the movement, just so I can keep track of where they are. It's not really a part that gets dirty. Unless they're rusty, then they need to come out and be sorted out. So yeah, I don't think there's too much more exciting at the disassembly this movement. So I'm going to do a fast film of that, time lapse, and you can enjoy me putting it back together in real time. Alright, movement has been cleaned and I've fitted the shock protection jewels. This shock protection design is the Eterna U and definitely the inspiration for Citizen's Parashock shock protection, which came a few years later. So yeah, now I'll take the balance off again and put the gear train into the movement. Hopefully things will go straight forward as I've already done the bushing for the barrel. Gently lift the balance cock off, like so. That to the side. Get my oils, a little bit of red oil onto the walls of both the barrel and center wheel. I'll start by fitting the center wheel. It's a very modern design where the sweep second is actually driven by a wheel overlaying the center wheel. Which eliminated the need for a little pinion, which was used on so many other brands. So that you don't need any tension spring on your sweep second mechanism. So it's a very nice construction in that way. And in the early 50s, late 40s, Eterna really went to town when it came to decorating the movements, very high finishes everywhere. Surface on my screwdriver has actually gotten a little rough, so I'm going to replace that. So a new blade in place, and that's much better. It's very important to keep your screwdriver blades as straight and sharp as possible at all times. that the setting of the screw, which goes in from the top, so you want to fit it now and not later on, because then you'll have to take your bridge off again. Give a tiny little droplet of oil here, and now we can fit our third wheel. Escape wheel. Fourth wheel, also the sweep second wheel. You see the barrel engages with the second wheel here, down here, and then to the third wheel, then the fourth, and then the escape wheel. Very nice compact construction. Also allows for a decent sized balance. Now I can fit the train bridge, the gear train bridge. Barrel. And before I can fit the barrel bridge, I have to fix the ratchet wheel to the underside. Or the crown wheel, sorry. You have this protective bushing that goes around there, or for the inner ring, and this comes in like this. Sorry, I'm babbling a bit as I'm also focusing on the job ahead. In place. Good. I'm going to put a droplet of oil onto the. Onto the bushing pivot, the barrel arbor pivot on the top. Here's the ratchet wheel. You can see it's the finished side up. sure that engages properly with the click. Like so, excellent. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to go under the microscope. I'm going to oil the gear train jewels, and I'm also going to flip the movement around, oil the other side, and we're going to start putting the winding and setting mechanism back in place. All right, let's start putting the winding and setting mechanism together. And I always start with, I usually start with the sliding and winding pinion and fitting the stem. So here I put a little bit of blue grease on the surface of where the yoke lever engages with the sliding pinion. There's a bit of blue grease on the surface of the well, that's the sliding pinion, and this is the winding pinion. So. So the key is to find all your surface points that slide and make sure that they have some lubrication that will assist with that action. It's amazing what, if you don't put grease on certain parts, how things like setting mechanism can suddenly be very hard to operate, and you'll have to force it, which causes unnecessary wear and can damage your movement if the friction is too high. So bending and breaking parts, you don't want to do that. Let's put a little bit of grease on here. So the principle is basically that when this sliding pinion is pushed in, you'll wind a movement because these teeth will engage. When you're not winding, they disengage because they're slanted. And when you pull the lever out, the setting lever that will be here, you push the yoke upwards, engaging the winding. So here's the setting lever, and as I mentioned earlier, the setting lever spring comes in from the other side, so what I have to do is I secure the setting lever with my finger, and hopefully we can catch the thread from the top. Like so. Perfect. Tighten that gently, don't want to go too tight. When you're working on a watch like this, you've got it's a balance of torquing your screws just the right amount, as if you do it too tight, you might break the screw off or make it so tight that the next person to take the movement apart will have problems with it. And if you do it, if you don't torque it enough, your screw will, after a while, find its way out of its position and block your movement. I did have I have another watch I'm working on, actually quite a modern Breitling chronomat or whatever they're called, but it has a Sellita 200.1 movement. I don't think it's ever been serviced, but the entire, I might add in a little photo here, just for reference, the entire auto winder mechanism had come loose, and the owner kept wearing the watch because it was still running, miraculously enough, until all of a sudden stopped. I'll show you a picture after I've fitted the setting mechanism here, and you can make your own conclusion why that brightling stopped. But yeah, that's how it can go if you don't tighten your screws enough. Anyway, what I've done here is fit the yoke, and you've got the yoke spring. So the yoke spring allows us to move, or keep it in winding position, and also move, help it move down when you're setting it, taking it out of setting position back into winding position. What I'm fitting now is the setting lever spring. The main function of the setting lever spring is to hold the setting lever in both winding position and setting position, mainly setting position. You got a little bit of pelage on the top of the base plate here, and a very nice finish on the beveled outer diameter of the movement. Very nice, overall, very nicely made, and I like these. Very similar to the, well, the base movement here is pretty much similar to the 1249, if I'm not mistaken. So it has a customized bridge and no auto winder mechanism. But it almost has a bit nicer finish than the 1249. So if you were to do a point comparison, you could add a little bit for the finishing. That barrel bridge is very nicely made, if it's not worn, of course. That was the cannon pinion. The main reason for a cannon pinion is that it can slide on your center wheel or post, and it allows you, it will, the friction drives the hands, and it's not tight enough, so when you actually want to override the gear train to set the time, it's loose enough to slide on the center wheel without causing damage. Excuse me. And that is your pretty standard layout for time for you know, your winding and setting mechanism. The this is your intermediate wheels here. This is your intermediate it goes from minutes here to the hour wheel. The hour wheel comes to the top of here, but I'll fit that later on because I'm going to flip the movement around and it will fall off. So I'll fit the hour wheel just before putting the dial back onto the movement. So we've got this little bridge here, a couple of lovely small screws. High finish on the screw heads. It's amazing to think that this was made, well, 70 years ago now. There we go, combine a movement. We can set it. So, because there's no pallet fork in the movement at the moment, you can see how the friction is strong enough to actually move the gear train around. But once we put the pallet fork in, that's no longer going to be possible. Unwind it. Nice. Nice free moving gear train. Now with an extra jewel. Another hot rod job by myself. I'm proud of that hot rod job. I'm not going to be too fast. So I'm going to check this under the microscope to make sure the pivot is lined up with the pallet fork before I tighten the screw. And then I'm going to put a little droplet of oil on the pallet fork jewels and distribute it around the movement. Well, not the movement, on the escape wheel. When that's done, we're actually ready to wind it up and put the balance in place. So the pallet fork has been fitted and oiled. So happy with that. And now it's time for the moment of truth. I'm pretty confident that this watch will start ticking straight away by fitting the balance. There we go, beautiful. It's almost like I've done this 2,000 times before. I'm going to pop this, let's see if this, there we go, it's quite all the way down. Now it's the way it should be. I did think that balance looked a bit wonky all of a sudden, but now it's nice and straight the way it should be. So proof's in the pudding, let's put this on the timer graph and see how she does. +8 seconds, beat error 0.1, amplitude 311 degrees, fully wound. What can I say? No adjustment needed. Might be because I serviced this watch a few years ago and I got the beat error and adjustments pretty much where it should be. Nobody's been touching it since. Good. It's only been worn, and the main issue we serviced it again was actually the worn upper bushing, and well, just being dry and in need of, you know, this doesn't hurt doing a routine service. So I think it's about eight years ago I serviced this, so happy with that. And now it's going to last another 10, I'm sure, especially with the new oils, and the there's not going to be any more wear in that upper bushing for a very long time with it being jeweled. Let's pop this around, dial side up. +11 seconds, +15 seconds. So it's going about 7 seconds faster dial side up. So I might adjust this down a tiny bit to about +3 seconds dial down. That would equalize that a bit. All right, let's do crown facing south, downwards. OK. Okay, minus about 1 second a day. So good amplitude, fantastic. We're in a positional variation. Or watch this age. Dial north. Look at that. Very good. Using about 3 seconds a day. Dial west, so left. Not dial, I mean crown. Let's reset this so we can see where we're at. Minus 6 seconds. Now I've turned it around again, so now the crown is pointing east, so to the right. That's 4 seconds. Minus 8. So, yeah, with the settings it is now being worn, I think this is going to keep well, almost ETA like performance. Settling again, we've got dial down, amplitude going up, and it will start gaining a bit of time again. So I'm actually quite happy with the setting, because if you have a little bit of time gaining on dial up, dial and down position, and a little bit of loss on the side, it's going to perform very well on the wrist. And I know the owner of this watch is intending to wear it, so perfect. So, time to fit the hour wheel. The hour wheel will get a tiny droplet of oil up against the surface here of the cannon pinion. So, we'll fit the little dial washer here to prevent the hour wheel from lifting up. Now we can place the dial back in place. So, and we can fit the hands. So, make sure that the hands don't touch the dial. Very important. Just also, it can't ride up too far neither. Some people prefer hand setting tool, where you put the movement in this holder and you can press it down from the top. I like doing it by hand because it's a lot of time on all these old watches that the hands are a bit wonky. Through various attempts at removing them through the ages, and I find that by doing it by hand, I got a bit more control of having them line up in a way where they're not going to touch. Being a no date movement, I kind of just need the 12 o'clock to be fairly accurate, so that when your hour and minute hand goes over 12, that it looks good. Somewhere there. Also the 6 o'clock, so we'll see how it lines up. stuff. Happy with that. Again, just gonna tighten this in the right spot so they don't touch. There we go. A tiny bit of clearing in there. Guess I could try and do that a little bit better. There we go, spot on. So I don't know if you can see that on the camera, but there is actually, let's see if we can zoom in. It's not focusing, but there is enough clearance there where it won't touch. That's what I want. And the last one to hand to be fitted is the sweep second hand. Very nice having all the original hands in place on this movement. The key is to make sure nothing touches. So now we're going to fit the movement into the case again. Like so. Refit the crown. So last thing to do is fit the screw back case back on this. Get a view of that. Very nice finish on the inside of the case back. There we have it. Fantastic Eterna, manual wind, beautiful case, beautiful dial, yeah, really like it. I think Eterna from this time period is very underrated, and as you can see in the service video, the finish of the movement should speak for itself. Anyway, hope you enjoy that. Until next time, I hope you have a good one. Cheers.